Item number, SCP-362. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-362 is to be stored in a polypropylene bag and kept in a standard lockbox. This lockbox is to be kept in a dedicated room with no materials pertaining to other SCPs, including handwritten and/or typed files, smartphones, PDAs, post-it notes, memos, or etc. Electronic devices with access to the internet and/or on-site intranet are forbidden from entering and/or accessing said room. Containment chambers should include non-relevant books and magazines, along with blank notebooks, for observation purposes. Only persons possessing level 1 clearance or lower may receive authorization to enter the containment chamber and wear SCP-362, which shall be done for research purposes and for said purposes only. Dr. and O5 possess keys unlocking SCP-362's lockbox. No other copies may be made without O5 authorization. Two security personnel must bar access to anyone not possessing the required clearance, and at least one surveillance camera must monitor each of the following for both research and security purposes. Exterior of chamber entryway, interior of chamber entryway, lockbox, and the chamber itself. Description. SCP-362 is a light blue t-shirt bearing the logo of a children's Saturday morning cartoon television program, popular in the late 1980s and early 90s. It is a size M, medium, with short sleeves. Its color appears to have faded, and was likely a darker shade of blue. Its tag states the t-shirt is made of 100% cotton. Testing has confirmed this statement. Despite its apparent age, it is in good condition, apart from said fading. Its collar and sleeves are not worn or threadbare, and it has no holes or rips. Test subjects wearing SCP-362 have unanimously reported no feelings of discomfort, unease, or foreboding. Five subjects, whose ages range from 22 to 35, have expressed what can perhaps be informally phrased as amused nostalgia upon donning SCP-362. In tests, it has been worn as briefly as 3.6 seconds, and as long as days, with a mean duration of hours. Aside from the obvious inconvenience of wearing an item of clothing longer than a few days, the test subject in each case reported normal emotional responses. Upon donning SCP-362, its effects are immediate and almost invariable among tests, the only significant variable being the duration test subjects must endure the phenomenon before it ends. Immediately after pulling SCP-362 off over his or her head, the test subject reports several to dozens of humanoid figures suddenly appearing in the room with them. The figures appear after the instant the test subject's vision becomes obscured by the material of SCP-362 passing over the subject's eyes as it is removed. These figures present with absolutely indeterminate features. Most to all of these figures seem to fix their attention on the test subject, and unless approached will stand motionless. A test subject who moves around the test chamber will find that these figures also move, but only to keep their attention fixed on the subject, and/or to avoid physical contact with the subject. These figures will go as far as to phase through the confines of the test chamber to avoid contact with any living thing. The figures themselves have been variously described as blurry, mirages, and most commonly, as shadowy or made of shadows. Often, a few of these figures will seem to take no interest in the test subject, but will instead explore their surrounding environment. They will appear to touch items, rifle through piles of paper, page through books, operate computers, etc. Twice, a figure reportedly has appeared to handle and operate a device, like a Geiger counter, with which the figure seems to scan objects or take readings for the duration of the sighting. Upon review of archived episodes of the show appears never to have referenced or depicted anything resembling the figures which have appeared to all test subjects. After experimentation, test subjects, even those who expressed eagerness and/or amusement at the prospect of wearing SCP-362, express unease when prompted to discuss the show. In light of Incident SCP-362-2, and in order to avoid cross-contamination of SCPs and prevent security breaches, no items, information, or personnel of Level 2 clearance or higher may ever be present in SCP-362's chamber prior to, during, or immediately after experimentation. Furthermore, under no circumstances may SCP-362 be worn by any person for longer than 9 days. Addendum. Immediately prior to said incident, test subject had worn SCP-362 for 31 days. As per research protocol, test subject had not been informed of the effects of donning SCP-362. Upon removal, site experienced a containment breach, which lasted minutes when primary and secondary power systems simultaneously failed. All debriefed personnel at said site reported experiencing feelings of dread during the breach, many of whom were trapped in rooms without power or means of egress when failsafe systems activated. Some personnel reported the sensation that other persons inhabited the room with them during the breach, despite being alone immediately beforehand. Many personnel felt as though they were being watched. Immediately after the breach, upon restoration of secondary power, site personnel discovered files scattered, books open, and notes in disarray. IT division reported that several computers and other devices had accessed data expunged. Test subject expired due to ventricular fibrillation minutes after secondary power failed. Autopsy revealed abnormally high adrenaline levels in subject's bloodstream. Authorization to upgrade SCP-362 to Euclid Class, pending. Interview log for Experiment 362-1. Interviewer: Dr. with Dr. Test subject: D-1022. Time: 5 minutes. Data expunged. Doctor: please describe your surroundings. D-1022: I don't know. It's like an office, I guess. Papers, notepads, there's a box in front of me. Doctor: is anyone in the room with you? D-1022, chuckling: I thought you were watching me. You know, through cameras. Doctor: we are. Is there anyone in the room with you? D-1022: is there supposed to be? Ain't no one in here but me. Doctor: thank you. Please use the key provided to open the box in front of you, then put on what you find inside. D-1022, after brief silence: what, it's just a shirt? Oh, hell yeah! Ah, man, I used to watch that show all the time. Doctor: please put it on. D-1022: sure thing. Can I keep it? Doctor: with some amusement: I'm afraid not. D-1022: show us the shit. Subject sings what has been identified as the theme song of said children's program as he puts on SCP-362. D-1022: okay, it's on. So, what now? Doctor: you'll receive further instructions in 5 minutes. Until then, you may busy yourself with whatever you find in the room. Subject swivels back and forth in his chair as he hums aforementioned tune. At T-minus 3 minutes, he draws humanoid figures with a pen. Doctor: can you tell me why you've drawn those figures? D-1022: just keeping busy, like you said. Doctor: yes, but why those particular figures? D-1022: what? You're telling me you've never watched? Doctor: we reviewed some episodes, yes. D-1022, pointing: this is... come on, man, don't tell me you don't see the resemblance. Doctor, with amusement: oh yes, of course. It's the very likeness of him. D-1022: pfft, whatever. I'm a good artist. Doctor: time is up. You may remove that item of clothing. D-1022: all right. Subject removes SCP-362 over his head. The instant he can see again, D-1022 stumbles backwards against the desk behind him. D-1022: oh shit! Doctor: what's wrong? D-1022: what is this? What's going on? Doctor, please describe your surroundings. D-1022, who are all these people? Doctor, please describe what you see. D-1022, they're watching me. They're ghosts or something. Get me out of here. Doctor, you are not in any danger. Please describe them in further detail. D-1022, what do you want? What do you want? Subject rushes forward. D-1022, you want a piece of this? Stop f***ing moving! Doctor, you are not in any danger. Please do not attack them. Doctor to researcher, inaudible to D-1022. If he provokes them, maybe we'll get some new data. D-1022 continues to turn and lunge at unseen opponents for 16 seconds of silence. Then, D-1022, where'd they go? Doctor, they're gone? Describe how they went. D-1022, they just went. Just 1 minute they're there and then, what were they? D-1022 begins to shiver visibly. Doctor, is something wrong? Is it colder in the room? To researcher, can I get a temperature reading? Researcher, overlapping. It's normal. No change. Doctor, D-1022, is it colder in the room than it was before? D-1022, get me out of here. I'm not telling you anything else until you let me out. Data expunged. Experiment logs. 362-E005. Date 03-06-2000. D-2323. Recruited specifically for this experiment due to his skill at dart throwing. Wore SCP-362 for 5 minutes. After effects lasted 2 minutes and 36 seconds. During the period, D-2323 was encouraged to throw darts at the figures and report verbally on results. Due to panic which D-2323 experienced, subject utilized only 1 minute and 6 seconds of time available to him. Findings seem to confirm hypothesis based on previous experiments. Figures will phase through walls, blink in and out of visibility, and or move more quickly than seems possible in order to avoid contact with either biological objects or non-biological objects introduced into the chamber with hostile intent. Data expunged. 362-E012. Date 05-12-2000. 44 D-class personnel introduced into chamber prior to experimentation. Subjects became claustrophobic. Staff introduced a mild tranquilizing gas into chamber to avoid compromising the experiment. Afterward, D-3197 wore SCP-362 for 5 minutes, and, during that time, led the other participants in a chorus of the television show's theme song. This appears to have been the result of introducing the gas into the chamber, and is likely not an effect of SCP-362, though further experimentation may be necessary to confirm this hypothesis. After D-3197 was instructed to remove SCP-362, he reported seeing figures for approximately 2 minutes and 30 seconds. Immediately upon removal, 9 D-class personnel disappeared from the chamber. D-3197 reported that, where the vanished D-class personnel had stood, the figures appeared in their place. Remaining D-class personnel exhibited signs of panic, despite lacking the ability to see the figures themselves. In order to avoid a possible containment breach due to D-class personnel overcoming the effects of the tranquilizer and causing damage to the test chamber and/or each other, a paralytic agent was introduced into the room. Incident log, SCP-3623. Date, undisclosed. After experiment 362-E012, researchers have identified anomalous data appearing on terminals during SCP-362 experimentation. First sample located on terminal's hard drive after post-experimentation scan. 2 more samples generated during E014 and E015. Current hypothesis posits a correlation between missing D-class personnel and content of anomalous data. Find a sample of said data attached. I was one who sang and one who watched the song, and now we watch the song and watch for signs. It is 2.957, it is 3.6602, it is 5.5. Repeating, it is 5, it is 4.3. It is 10,055,092.3, it is repeating. These are signs, there are more signs, but these are signs we have seen when we watch the song. The song. We see the song at all times, always at each time we see the song we have and duly note the sign of 3.6602 and the sign of 5.5 repeating it is repeating. These are the signs. 3.6602, 5.5, repeating. 2.957, 5, 4.3, 10,055,093.3. We are watching the signs at all times. We are watching then and now we duly note that we are watching. Item number, SCP-311. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. Contained in High Security Item Storage Unit G78 at Sector 28. Sealed to all personnel without written authorization from 3 Level 4 or higher senior staff. Item barred for use in further research. Pending 05 comprehensive review. Description. SCP-311 is a pair of plain black gloves. They exhibit extreme flexibility, which allows them to fit every hand size tested. Object was recovered from a professed voodoo practitioner, implicated in several suspicious murders and following the incident, the body and all the subject's belongings, including the gloves, were appropriated by the Foundation for containment and study. When worn, the gloves seem innocuous and present no danger to the wearer. Subject responds normally to trauma inflicted on any part of the body, except the hands where the gloves are worn. All trauma and sensation of any tested kind inflicted on the subject's hands is displaced to another individual, theorized to be an individual the subject is focusing on at the time. Both gloves need to be worn for this effect to occur, but the subject need not be aware of the item's properties. Test log 311-1. Test 1C. Test subjects. D238746, D892201. Stimulus. Wartenberg pinwheel. Dr. Silas. All right, how do those gloves feel? D238746. Okay. Comfortable? I guess. Dr. Silas. Good. Now, focus on your partner. Dr. Silas rolls the pinwheel across D238746's gloved hand. D892201. What the fuck? I felt that! Dr. Silas. Interesting. End log. Test 2A. Test subjects. D238746. D892201. Stimulus. Hypodermic needle. Dr. Silas. Okay, now focus on your partner. Inserts hypodermic needle.
Ow! I said focus on your partner!
D892201. Why, doctor? Did you feel a little poke? Dr. Silas. That's irrelevant. If you don't... Sounds of a scuffle.
Guards! Restrain the subject!
Agent Tyler enters the room. Dr. Silas.
Quick, he has the needle in his... You son of a b***! Shoot him!
Gunshots. End log. Instructions for the following test were issued through a speaker, using voice modulation, and D-class personnel employed were not exposed to any Foundation personnel prior to the test. Test 4D. Test subjects. Data expunged. Stimulus. Concentrated sulfuric acid basin. Dr. Silas. See those people on the other side of the glass? Focus on them while your hands are placed in the basin. Subject's hands lowered by robotic manipulator. After a brief pause, subject D845224 in adjacent room begins to scream, and his hands show signs of acid burns. D... My God, what's happening to him? Why don't the others help?
Original subject's screams subside. Subject D986720 begins screaming. D... Is that happening to every person I think about? Oh my god. You have to stop this now. Please, stop! Oh my god. Oh my god. Subject continues pleading until end of log. End log. Note. Subject's wife and daughter were admitted to hospital later that day, presenting with severe acid burns on their hands and heavy blood loss. Was pronounced dead later that night. Directive 311-2. Due to the proven capabilities of SCP-311 and the serious possibility of misuse, it has been decided to isolate it in a Level 4 classified location, pending review. It is also true that the artifacts might prove useful in extreme situations, where handling dangerous SCPs proves necessary. In such an event, the use of SCP-311 as supplementary containment equipment will be evaluated on a case-by-case basis. Dr. Item Number SCP-288. Object Class Safe. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-288 is to be kept in a locker, with only security personnel of level 2 clearance or higher given the combination. They are currently contained in the small velvet-lined black box they were retrieved in. Personnel who have worn the rings during testing are to undergo full psychological exams afterward, and their experience is recorded. Description: SCP-288 consists of a woman's engagement ring, hereafter referred to as SCP-2881, and matching men's band, hereafter referred to as SCP-2882, both silver in appearance, the ring containing a small diamond. They are relatively plain, and bear no marks as to their origin or make, but staff routinely describe them as seeming like very nice wedding rings, if a little plain. They are completely normal in every sense, and have been damaged by endurance testing, and subsequently repaired through typical jeweling practices, and their effects are only observable while worn. When SCP-2881 is worn by any adult female in a relationship, she immediately becomes what has been portrayed in popular media as an ideal housewife. Women describe this experience as if they are not in control of their body, merely observing their own actions. They lose all ability to form their own opinions, and instead automatically agree with the opinions of their spouse, and display very few negative emotions, if any. They seem to gain an instinctive knowledge of cooking and baking, in the style considered to be the, quote, traditional American style, including such dishes as apple pie or macaroni and cheese. These dishes are always professionally made, regardless of prior skill. A similar knowledge is evidenced in the spheres of cleaning and light repair. Subjects regularly display the ability to sew and knit, even if they were not able to do so before donning SCP-2881. Along with this knowledge, they feel an innate urge to cook, clean, and mend things around their home incessantly. They lose the will to have a job of their own, and become exceedingly obedient and loyal to their spouse, as well as religious and authority figures. Many wearers of SCP-2881 exhibit a fondness for rather modest dress, and are uncomfortable when wearing pants or more revealing clothing. They also develop a fondness for children, and if they do not already have children, express the urge to have them. When SCP-2882 is worn by any adult male in a relationship, he undergoes a similar change, taking on the characteristics of popular media's portrayal of an all-American dad, whether or not he has children of his own. Men describe the experience similarly to women, in that they feel they are not in control of their actions. He shows loyalty and obedience to political, religious, and authority figures, and an innate duty to his current professional management structure. He will work exceedingly long hours without complaint, and maintains an upbeat and motivated demeanor at his work. No matter the nature of his former personality, he becomes friendly and easy to approach, good with kids, and fiercely loyal to his spouse. He is always willing to help around the house, and willing to please with a shoulder rub. Men with children become attentive, engaged fathers, and men without children express a strong desire to have them. When used collectively, SCP-288 seems to recreate a model of a Stepford marriage.
While this seems ideal and relatively harmless, SCP-288 has been responsible for numerous crimes, including spousal abuse, murder, and suicide. Both women and men report feeling trapped while wearing SCP-288 and out of control of their own life. After extended periods of wearing SCP-288, they often have intense feelings of depression and personality displacement. On a more sinister note, somebody wearing either instance of SCP-288 will take virtually any manner of abuse from a spouse without a word or raising a hand to defend themselves. In transsexual or transgender individuals, the ring appears to react to their gender identity. Therefore, a transsexual or transgender individual assigned male at birth would react to the female ring rather than the male ring, whether or not they were pre- or post-gender reassignment surgery. Homosexual subjects are affected by their actual gender. A male homosexual will not react to the female ring, just as a female homosexual will not react to the male ring. More testing upon sex and gender is pending. The potential for SCP-288 to create a domestic slave proves disturbing to some and seems useful to others, and records show that it has been used in such a fashion before. Preliminary testing of SCP-288 has proved inconclusive. The rings themselves display no physical anomalies compared to a normal wedding ring of similar type. It is theorized that the rings profile their subjects mimetically, drawing on the experiences present in the subject to influence their behavior upon activation. This theory is supported by SCP-288's ability to differentiate subjects based on their self-perception of gender rather than their physical sex. SCP-288 was discovered by Dr. Wrights and data expunged. Thankfully, her boyfriend grew wary of her extreme mood changes and called the emergency SCP contact number she had left for him, delivering SCP-288 into the Foundation's hands. I'm just glad I got suckered into it before somebody else did, even if it was horrible, Dr. Wrights. It should be noted that both instances of SCP-288 resist being separated, and wearers may feel compelled to buy or even steal the rings in order to keep them nearby. Addendum 288A. It has been revealed through extensive backtracking of SCP-288's history that it has been associated with upwards of 25 instances of homicide, between 13 and 15 suicides, and 2 reported cases of spousal abuse. It has regularly resurfaced in pawn shops across the United States for at least 80 years, though all attempts to track it past the early 20th century have failed to reveal further evidence. Item number SCP-269. Object Class: Safe. Special Containment Procedures: SCP-269 is stored in a standard Safe Class secure locker at Site-19. Experimentation with SCP-269 may only be performed on Class D personnel, and only with prior approval from at least 2 Level 3 senior researchers. Description: SCP-269 is an unmarked bracelet composed of red jade, approximately 11 centimeters in diameter in its inactive state. SCP-269 exhibits unusual resilience, as all attempts at obtaining a sample have failed to date, as well as constantly maintaining a temperature of approximately 36 degrees Celsius, regardless of ambient room temperature. When placed on the wrist or ankle of a living human subject, SCP-269 contracts to fit tightly but comfortably over the extremity. Over the next 24 hours, SCP-269 extends flexible tendrils that integrate with its host's circulatory system through the ulnar and radial arteries, a process described by test subjects as being painless but mildly uncomfortable. Upon completion of this process, SCP-269 cannot be removed from its host without amputating the affected hand or foot. Once SCP-269 is fully integrated, it will begin to filter substances from its host's bloodstream. How this is done is not fully understood, but the process occurs over 3 stages. In the first stage, SCP-269 will begin to filter contaminants and infectious agents, such as bloodborne bacteria and viruses. This includes many disease agents that are currently incurable, such as the human immunodeficiency virus, HIV. SCP-269 appears to be capable of identifying and isolating infected blood cells from healthy ones, as this process often results in a general improvement in the health of the host. The host may resist attempts to have SCP-269 removed. This stage typically lasts anywhere from 1 week to 1 month. In the second stage, SCP-269 will begin filtering components of the host's immune system from the bloodstream. Because SCP-269 continues to filter infectious agents from the host's body, this generally goes unnoticed, unless a blood analysis is performed. Stage 2 lasts anywhere from 1 month to 6 months. In the final stage, SCP-269 will begin to filter vital blood components, such as red blood cells and platelets, causing an onset of acute anemia and thrombocytopenia. Hosts that reach stage 3 quickly weaken and will invariably expire within 1 week, unless massive blood transfusions are given. SCP-269 came to the Foundation's attention following reports that a civilian, one Mr. had been cured of acquired immune deficiency syndrome, AIDS, and died shortly thereafter. SCP-269 was discovered attached to Mr. Rand's wrist and was secured by Foundation agents after it was found that SCP-269 had integrated into his circulatory system. Investigation into the precise function and origin of SCP-269 is ongoing. Item Number SCP-268. Object Class Euclid. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-268 is currently to be maintained within Data Expunged, as it has been deemed that the change of use for the facilitation of escape by restricted personnel or humanoid SCP is too great. However, the possibility of use by field agents after further testing is under review. Note: Special Containment Procedures have been modified. See Addendum 268-05 for detailed information. Description: SCP-268 is a tweed wool newsboy cap. The design and make seem to be of Irish origin. Due to the style and fabric, it is estimated to have been created in the late 1800s to early 1900s, though fiber analysis is inconclusive. The only markings on the cap are a small label with writing in Middle Irish, reading, "The garden is the serpent's place." However, there are various indications that this label was sewn onto the cap in recent times. Due to the nature of the artifact, testing has been extremely difficult. SCP-268 seems to be a normal hat until it is worn. Anyone wearing the hat, however, suddenly and instantly becomes unnoticeable. Subjects become unmemorable, thoroughly ignorable, or taken for granted by all observers. Observers, with specific prompting, are able to later recall physically seeing the subject, but can give no specific details other than seeing a man with a hat. Observers seem to have the overwhelming feeling that the wearer is someone that was supposed to be there, and thus did not merit thought or notice. During initial testing, remote analysts completely forgot what they were supposed to be observing within the chamber, and it was not until the D-class subject wearing SCP-268 spoke out loud that he was noticed again. Removal of the artifact, vocalization, and physical interaction with observers seem to be the only way in which wearers of SCP-268 can make themselves noticeable. Once an observer has been made to notice an SCP-268 wearing individual, they slowly begin to ignore the subject once more, unless kept actively engaged by the wearer. Testing reveals that if a subject wears SCP-268 upward of 20 cumulative hours, its effects seem to linger, with diminished potency, on the subject even while not wearing the artifact. Testing in this area has been cautious due to the possibility of containment breaches, but one incident has shown that if the artifact is worn long enough, that the effect is rendered permanent and unbreakable. Extensive research is still unable to determine whether or not electronics are directly affected by SCP-268. Observers viewing an SCP-268 wearing subject through electronic means still have difficulty acknowledging the subject's existence, and even when noticed, observers report to be unable to see the face of the individual in question. Observers note pictures of SCP-268 wearing individuals as being blurry, and digital media such as surveillance cameras is reported to become grainy and unfocused. Research is unsure whether these alterations are extant and physical, or merely perceived due to SCP-268's properties. It should be noted that although capturing SCP-268 through visual electronic means has been difficult, motion sensing, weight sensing, heat seeking, and similar devices all trigger correctly when encountering an SCP-268 wearing subject. Addendum 268-01. SCP-268 is noted to have some similarities to SCP-180. SCP-268, however, does not seem to function on inanimate objects, and more importantly, does not directly steal the identity of its host. While SCP-180 causes its host to become unrecognizable after SCP-180 itself is removed and placed on another object, this seems to be a side effect of its function of identity theft and transfer. Meanwhile, SCP-268 could be said to steal the identity of longtime wearers, as they become irrevocably forgotten. This has caused some speculation as to whether the items share similar origins, or whether the many similarities they share are merely coincidental. Addendum 268-02. At Agent B's request, and after approval by Dr. and Dr. Klein, SCP-268 is being used with agents in active field duty. Results thus far have been favorable. Addendum 268-03. Field testing has been suspended. Though Agent appears to have been on payroll and on records, no personnel, either on site or in higher command, remember knowing or hearing about an Agent. Further tests should be conducted only on D-class personnel and on no single individual for longer than 10 hours. Addendum 268-04. SCP-268's effects seem to strengthen and become permanent as individual subjects wear the artifact for extended periods of cumulative time. There is a marked difference in the potency of SCP-268's effect on someone wearing it for the first time and someone who has worn the artifact upwards of 5 hours on other occasions. For example, someone who has not worn the cap before seems to dispel its effects merely by speaking. Those who have worn the artifact on several occasions for extended amounts of time seem to be able to ask observers questions and receive answers, with the observer having little to no recollection of the event. In one test, a subject who had worn the artifact for upwards of 15 hours was able to ask standing personnel the test chamber's password, nearly causing a containment breach and the escape of D-class personnel. The security personnel in question reported being unable to recall parting with the information in question. Dr. Klein. Addendum 268-05. As of SCP-268 is missing. Its absence was discovered early in the morning by Agent and research analysts, and in its place was a note reading, "Thanks, I needed my hat back. L.S." A full investigation of this security breach has been launched. Item number, SCP-262. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. Currently, SCP-262 is undergoing review and research to see if it is capable of being used by field agents in the acquisition of other SCPs. Monitored use by commander-level authority is preferable. It is inadvisable to allow agents unsupervised usage of SCP-262 at this time. When not in use, SCP-262 is kept in a climate-controlled room at site, guarded by at least 2 Level 2 security personnel. Description: SCP-262 is a light brown European military-style greatcoat from a period between the late 1500s to the early 1900s. It is without any specific designations or markings, leading researchers to believe it was an original archetype sample, intended to be submitted to military officials for approval as part of a new uniform design. The pattern was either rejected or lost because it was never implemented. It is made of wool and extends below the knee on most individuals. Carbon dating of the coat fibers has been inconclusive, placing the age of SCP-262 in the range of 6,200 to 6,400 years old. One explanation is that the wool used to create SCP-262 is perhaps thousands of years old, but the coat itself was cut, sewn, and assembled recently. SCP-262 is capable of manifesting numerous arms from within the dark inner lining. When worn, any subject wearing SCP-262 needs only to open the coat to materialize hands and arms, which are somewhat under the subject's control. Most limbs are human in nature, and vary in skin tones, length, and strength. A noted few include a reptilian-like scaled tentacle, some 4 meters or 13 feet long. 4 semi-transparent arm-like appendages made of cellulose, over 10 meters or 33 feet long, with 4 fingers, 2 elbow-like joints, and no wrists. The clawed paw of a large cat, possibly a cougar or mountain lion. Several feet and legs that appear randomly. The space under SCP-262 is considered to be non-Euclidean in nature, and the coat itself divergent from normal dimensions. In one instance, test subject 402M was told to put SCP-262 over his head. Upon doing so, SCP-262 fell to the ground, as the Class D personnel disappeared under it. Sometime later, fingerprinting of objects that have come into contact with the limbs of SCP-262 have identified one of the arms as that of Subject 402M. Subjects properly wearing SCP-262 are able to manipulate these arms with a varying amount of control. Test Subject 301F was able to perform multiple tasks at once, even while unaware and blindfolded, leading researchers to believe that SCP-262 has both perception and awareness of its surroundings, even when the subject does not. Some believe SCP-262 to be fully sentient, due to observing SCP-262 playing a piano with 2 or more hands, though the test subject has had no formal training in music, defending itself and subject from multiple attackers, several limbs fighting one another, or even going against the subject's will. At times, when a subject attempts to smoke, a particular limb will remove the cigarette from the subject's mouth and then throw it away. At other times, a different hand will place a cigarette into the subject's mouth and light it, though the subject dislikes smoking. Acquisition. SCP-262 came into the Foundation's care when the administrator relinquished his ownership of the coat in the late 20th century. Because of his status, the administrator is granted special rights which effectively allow him to remain silent about the origins of SCP-262, how he came to possess it, and how he has used it in the past. The administrator released SCP-262 to the Foundation, stating, "In the right hands, it could be extremely useful. In the wrong hands, it could be extremely dangerous. In my hands, it was becoming extremely dusty and moth-ridden, and taking up far too much space in my closet." Addendum 1. Selected notes from further research regarding the properties of SCP-262. Case Study 26211. Inversion of SCP-262. Trial 7. After putting on SCP-262 properly, Subject 722M attempts to turn the right arm sleeve inside out as he removes his arm. Many disembodied voices cry in apparent pain. Subject 722M is instructed to continue inverting the sleeve. Multiple arms emanating from within the lining of SCP-262 reach out and attack Subject 722M. In an attempt to remove the coat, Subject 722M tries to retract his arm, but in doing so, inverts the sleeve of the coat. A long cellulitic arm appears from the opposite inner lining, reaches around and up through the inverted sleeve, grasps Subject 722M's caught hand, and pulls violently, the force of which dislocates the subject's shoulder and amputates the arm at the elbow. With SCP-262 in typical position, all emanating arms retreat, and audible wailing of voices cease. Subject 722M's wounds are treated, and his condition is inconsequential. Case Study 26242. Placement of SCP-262 on a mannequin. Trial 1. SCP-262 was placed on an anatomically correct human male mannequin, dressed in typical SCP personnel attire. After several minutes, a single human arm emanating from the inner lining of SCP-262 reaches up towards the mannequin's face. After several prods of apparent curiosity, the arm retreats, and no further movement is recorded for the duration of the test. Trial 4. SCP researchers place SCP-262 over the head and shoulders of a similar but different mannequin. After a few moments, SCP-262 fell to the ground, with the entirety of the test mannequin disappearing below it. Addendum. It has been noted that a rigid wooden arm resembling that of the test mannequin has been witnessed emanating from SCP-262 since this trial. Case Study 262307. Placement of SCP-262 on a recently deceased human being. Trial 1. Research personnel put SCP-262 onto the body of a recently deceased Class D personnel, recently terminated, in an experiment with SCP expunged. The body is whole, unscathed, and mounted into a seated position on a chair. After a few moments, a single human arm emanating from the inner lining of SCP-262 reaches up towards the body's face. After several prods of apparent curiosity, the arm retreats. After several more moments, the body which SCP-262 is on begins shaking violently. A popping and snapping sound is heard, and the deceased's hands, visible at the end of the sleeves, suddenly retract. The body then stills. A human hand reaches up the back of the deceased neck from the collar and pulls the head up into an upright position. Numerous hands and arms crisscross the chest and abdomen and straighten the body. Two cellulitic arms reach down the body's legs and grip the ankles. SCP-262 pulls the body into a standing position as other arms of cellulose come down each sleeve. SCP-262 continues by breaching containment and overpowering security. At the time, MTF-Epsilon-9, aka Fire Eaters, were present in the facility to provide reinforcements. Discharging their flame accelerators in an aggressive fashion, members of MTF-E9 were able to corner SCP-262 in a blind hallway. When cornered, a hand from within SCP-262 pulled the coat up and over the head of the body it was using. SCP-262 collapsed to the ground with the body of the Class D personnel disappearing beneath it. It is unknown if the incident was caused by the will of SCP-262 or the will of the body of the recently deceased Class D personnel used.
Item Number SCP-399. Object Class Safe. Special Containment Procedures. When not being worn by a human being, SCP-399 is inert. SCP-399 is to be kept in a locked safe at facility when not in use. Testing of SCP-399 requires Level 4 approval and is only to be handled by personnel who have received a rating of clear or better on Psychological Profile 399-17. Any generators, power plants, or similar energy sources in the vicinity of testing are to be dedicated exclusively for testing and should not be used to power any other mission essential equipment or facilities. As a result of experiments 399-4 and 399-5, testing of SCP-399 on human subjects requires Level 5 approval and is to be conducted in isolation from other SCPs or sensitive facilities. Under no circumstances is SCP-399 to be tested or stored in the vicinity of any free energy or perpetual motion device. Description: SCP-399 is a ring consisting of two metallic bands, linked by six metal bars, with six pieces of a transparent purple glass between them. The ring is of unknown make and bears no identifying stamps. When not being worn by a human being, SCP-399 is inert. When placed on a human being's finger, the ring activates, which is indicated by the six glass segments beginning to glow one by one. In testing, this process takes from 3 minutes to 6 hours, dependent on the availability of nearby energy sources. Once fully active,
The ring responds to spoken or mental commands from its wearer until removed, at which point it becomes inert until worn and re-energized. In this mode, SCP-399 is capable of manipulating or reshaping objects within a 5-meter radius of the wearer, at varying levels of complexity. By a currently unknown mechanism, SCP-399 draws in energy from its nearby environment with which to perform these functions. Minor tasks, such as causing a small object to levitate or turn itself inside out, require minor amounts of ambient energy, which is primarily drawn from the surrounding atmosphere, causing a temperature drop. At finer scales, progressively more energy is necessary, and SCP-399 has been known to draw energy from electrical generators, nuclear reactors, and data expunged to complete the reaction. If there is not sufficient energy within SCP-399's range, approximately 300 meters, to perform the operation, SCP-399 will draw on its wearer and data expunged. More detailed operations also carry a greater chance of catastrophic failure, resulting in data expunged of the wearer. The extent of SCP-399's ability to alter objects within its range appears to be solely a function of energy available to it. With an adequate power source, manipulation of objects at the atomic or subatomic level appears to be possible. SCP-399 came to the Foundation's attention on data expunged when a string of power outages and unusually cold weather were reported in the vicinity of data expunged. The object was located in the possession of a Mr. who had apparently become deceased during an attempt to use SCP-399 to change lead bars into gold. How he came into possession of the device has not been satisfactorily determined. SCP-399 does not appear to have any means of storing energy that has been drawn in. Simply drawing in the quantity it requires to perform a task and expending it immediately. It has been speculated, owing to the high energy demands of SCP-399, that it was intended for use in conjunction with a dedicated portable energy source of high volume. Such a device was not found among the effects of... In conjunction with such a device or an SCP of a similar nature, SCP-399 could potentially be used to devastating effect, as a weapon of mass destruction, or to neutralize other Keter-class SCPs. Due to the potential negative consequences of a failure on this scale, this line of experimentation is not to be explored at this time. Experiment Log 399. Experiment 399-1. Date: expunged. User: Dr. Subject: one phone book. User attempts to open book to page 368. Experiment successful. Ambient temperature of test chamber drops by 4.8 kelvins. Experiment 399-2. Date: expunged. User: Dr. Subject: one t-shirt, colored blue. User attempts to change shirt's color to red. Experiment successful. Power brownouts reported in nearby sections of facility. Ambient temperature of test chamber drops by 9.7 kelvins. Experiment 399-3. Date: expunged. User: Dr. Subject: one phone book. User attempts to cause text of book to be translated from English to French. Experiment successful. On-site electrical generator overloads and fails, causing loss of primary power to facility for 6 hours. Ambient temperature of test chamber drops by 17.4 kelvins. Experiment 399-4. Date: expunged. User: Dr. Subject: one phone book, 3D-class personnel. Special test protocols. Experiment 399-4 was conducted in remote facility. All electrical sources in the area were deactivated except those necessary to power monitoring equipment. User attempts to cause text of book to be translated from English to French. Experiment successful. D-class personnel are data expunged. No significant reduction of ambient room temperature. Experiment 399-5. Date: expunged. User: Dr. Subject: remains of 1 D-class personnel from experiment 399-4. Special protocol: test conducted at remote facility. A dedicated nuclear reactor was provided as energy source. User attempts to restore D-class personnel to his physical condition prior to experiment 399-4. Nuclear reactor reaches 57% capacity. Subject is successfully reconstructed physically intact, but remains deceased. User attempts to restore subject to life. Data expunged. SCP-399 was recovered by hazmat personnel 48 hours later. Weather patterns in vicinity of facility site normalized within 96 hours. Radiological contamination of the region has been deemed within acceptable limits. Note: following the loss of Dr. Dr. C requested and was granted permission to conduct the following test on himself. Experiment 399-6. Date: expunged. User: Dr. C. Subject: Dr. C. User attempts to cause self to levitate. Successful. Upon initial levitation, room temperature begins to drop 1 Kelvin approximately every 0.68 seconds. Dr. C then begins to cause himself to hover slowly about the test chamber, which begins to produce electrical brownouts. The rate of temperature decrease increases to 1 Kelvin per 0.47 seconds at this time, and fluctuates as the rate of the doctor's movement is accelerated or slowed. The experiment is terminated after room temperature drops below 0 degrees centigrade. Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.